Professor Avanli, I think quite a few attendees have logged in. I request you to begin the webinar, and I'm sure the others will continue to log in.
Okay. Thank
Over
you
to
very
you, sir.
Thank you very much, Mr. Akshay. Namaskar to everyone. We're delighted to inform that as part of Symbiosis Golden Jubilee celebrations, Symbiosis Law School Noida, in association with Lex Witness, India's first magazine on legal and corporate affairs, has organized a webinar series titled Knowledge Series on Law and Advocacy in the month of October till December 2020. Live 4 of the series is scheduled today on evolving environmental jurisprudence in India. It is an honor for me to introduce to the resource person of the day, Ms. Anita Shenoy, Senior Advocate, Supreme Court of India. Ms. Anita became advocate on record in the year 2001 and is Senior Advocate, Supreme Court of India. Ms. Anita has been counsel for the High Court of Judicature at Hyderabad for the state of Andhra Pradesh and the state of Telangana since October 2016. She was standing counsel for the state of Karnataka from 2006 to 2016. She also has been advocate on the panel of the National Human Rights Commission since 2017, counsel for the National Legal Services Authority since 2013, special counsel for the state of Karnataka in mining, sugar, forest and infrastructure related cases since 2016, and there are many more. Ms. Anita has held positions of repute, including member Middle Income Group Legal Aid Society, Supreme Court of India since 2015, member Supreme Court Legal Services Committee, August 2013 to October 2017, legal advisor to Legal Initiative for Forest and Environment for Supreme Court litigation 2006 and onwards, member advisory board the Access Initiative for its report titled An Assessment of Access to Information, Public Participation and Justice, Environmental Democracy in Himalayas 2010, and legal advisor to the NGO platform on shipbreaking 2006 and onwards. She also has been part of various committees and panels, including consultant to the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare on issues of prenatal sex determination and sex selective abortions 2002-2003, member technical committee on amendments to the prenatal diagnostic techniques, regulations and prevention of misuse Act 1994, part of the campaign committee for the law on domestic violence 1999, coordinator for Far East Study Tour Group of the Women's Rights Initiative to examine models of domestic violence legislation, Philippines and Malaysia 2000, and consultant the Canadian International Development Agency on the Justice Delivery System 2000, and much more. I would now request Ms. Mayuri, who would moderate the today's session, to take it over.
Thank you, sir. Welcome, attendees. And before I request Madam to start such an enlightening session on such a interesting topic, I would like to, with ma'am's permission, place before the attendees the housekeeping rules. First of all, if you have any questions during the session, I request you to kindly place them in the Q&A box, which you can see on your screen. And I will place them before ma'am as and when she will permit it after her presentation is over. Secondly, towards the end of the session, we will also permit live questions. So in case you wish to go live with a question, you will be permitted to press the raise hand icon button that you see on your screen, and we will keep you make you go live as and when ma'am will permit us. So with this, I request ma'am to kindly start the session today. Thank you, ma'am, for coming and accepting our request.
Thank you very much. Welcome, attendees. Without much ado, I'll start my presentation. I have divided my presentation into 3-4 segments. The first segment is the state of environment as it is today. The second is about the various laws relating to environment. The third segment is the various principles in environmental jurisprudence, the case law, etc. And lastly, what are the present concerns? What are our future concerns in the field of environment, like threats relating to climate change, etc.? So, okay, my first slide, which is a very pretty blue slide. Let's go to the second slide. Okay, now these are very general slides. These slides will show you, on the ground, what is the state of environment. You know, it's only when you know what is the status of environment that you'll actually appreciate the laws better, the sense of enforcement better, you know, how the courts have needed to step in, you know. So this is like a base. This is what makes you understand that what is the reality that we're living in today. So the first slide says that India has the most polluted cities on earth. Now, if you look at this, Gurgaon, Ghaziabad, of course, Faisalabad is in Pakistan. You have Faridabad, you have Bhiwadi, Noida, Patna, Lucknow, Delhi, Jodhpur, and so on and so forth. So this is the status. And of course, Delhi and NCR, everybody is aware. You know, you can't breathe without an air purifier these days. Even in the Supreme Court, I mean, I've been practicing for the last 25 years, but in the last 3-4 years, every courtroom has an air purifier. So this is the kind of reality that we live in today. Next slide, please. Okay, now this, the first one was with reference to pollution. Now this is also something extremely alarming. The slide says India has lost 1,20,000 hectares of forests in the last 5 years, especially in Kerala and Karnataka, which have witnessed alarming decline. Now, what does this mean? When you say you've lost forests in the last 5 years, what does it mean? It means that forests have been diverted to non-forest uses. Now, you know, when you say a forest is diverted, it's not merely cutting down of trees. Now, forests are like carbon sinks. You know, they are like the lungs. You know, so when you cut down trees, it's not just cutting down trees or, you know, de-reserving forests. It leads to more landslides. It leads to more soil erosion. It leads to a lot of biodiversity loss and all the flora and fauna which live in these forests. Now, what happens is then, you know, you'll see something very simple, I'll tell you. You know, when you clear out forests, you'll see a lot of monkeys have shifted into the urban areas. You know, so you have all this. You'll see the black bucks, the nilgai. They're all now making, agricultural patches their homes. You'll see elephants moving in. Suddenly during the pandemic, you saw the leopards were moving around, you know, things like this. So there are a lot of impacts when you talk about forests being diverted. The next piece is on wildlife. Now, what do you mean when you say India denotifies 1,000 square kilometers of its protected areas? Now, what are protected areas? Protected areas are wildlife sanctuaries, right? Parks, national parks and wildlife sanctuaries. Now, what is a wildlife sanctuary? What is a national park? It is an area which says that, look, this is a boundary. And this area, this enclosed area is meant only for the wildlife. You know, you do have a traditional community sometimes living in forests and they have relocation programs, but this is a bounded area meant for the protection. So for instance, you have wildlife sanctuaries where you have, say, an endangered species there. You have wildlife sanctuaries and, you know, you have like turtle sanctuaries. And like in Karnataka, you have a rotten bat. So for the rotten bat, they had the Bhimgarh sanctuary, which was notified. So, you know, so when you talk about denotification of protected areas, it means you remove this protected area from the legal protection. When you, a no-go area, it's just no-go, no human interventions there. becomes a go area, which means you can use it for other purposes and it doesn't remain a protected area. So these three slides, and maybe even the next, these three slides show you that this is the alarming way, you know, with pollution, with decrease in forest cover, decrease in protected areas, how environment today has become so vulnerable. And so therefore, you know, more the need for protection, more the need for laws, etc. So the next slide, please. Right. Now, on one hand, you've seen the alarming rate. Most of the polluted cities in the world are in India. Now look at the sense of enforcement. I'm not giving you too much detail. This is, it says Indian cities are choking, but there have been just 6 air pollution convictions in 2014-16. So for 2 years, you've had only 6 air pollution convictions. So it gives you a sense of the enforcement lag. I mean, enforcement and implementation is so far behind. And, you know, that makes this, you know, this whole thing in terms of pollution so much more serious. Right. Next slide, please. Okay. Now, I have now finished one segment that was generally to give you a sense about what is the state of the environment. Now, the second segment is what are the laws relating to environment? So you have the Wildlife Protection Act, the Forest Conservation Act, Environment Protection Act, Water Act, Biological Diversity Act, Air Act. Now, I want to spend 1 minute to interestingly tell you about the genesis of these legislations. Now, how did the Wildlife Protection Act come about? Now, Wildlife Protection Act came about because there was a lot of tiger hunting, tiger poaching, and so a lot of environmentalists wrote to the then regime. And then that led to the introduction of the Wildlife Protection Act. I'll just give you some bare bones about this act. Now, what is this act? What does it do? So it does few things, okay? It says prohibition of hunting, right? One. Second, it tells you that you can declare and notify certain areas as wildlife sanctuaries. You can notify them as national parks, which means areas that deserve protection and no-go areas. It tells you, it divides all the species into schedules. You know, so you have schedule one species, you have elephants, tigers, etc., which require the maximum protection, right? And it also, there are interesting things that this act also does. It has evolved, though it's a 72 legislation. Can you, thank you. Though it's a 72 legislation, it has evolved. You know, interestingly, you could never take venom out of snakes. But there was an amendment. They said, no, if you want to prevent snake bite, you need an antidote. You need to extract venom. So there was an amendment which, you know, allowed you to take venom out of snakes, right? They've, you know, tiger is something that India is obsessed with, you know, out of all the wildlife species. So they had amendments to the Wildlife Protection Act saying you can have something called a tiger reserve, you know. And interestingly, you have a lot of, you have like areas like Corbett, Kana, etc., where, or I think Bandipur, you know. So in all these areas, what you found was that though there were tiger reserves, there was a lot of tourism. People are very interested in wildlife tourism. We know that. And then what is to happen is that, arey, tiger dekhne ke liye, they would be 6 baje se, there would be a huge line, you know, and waiting. And, you know, in areas, in sanctuaries, etc., where you have a radio caller, there's no problem. You know, the guy who would take you around, you have to get into their jeeps when you go into these areas. You know, they would know where the tiger is and say, everybody goes. And then there are 100 cameras. And then they felt that, no, this is not happening. You know, you can't go into their habitat and disturb them in this fashion. So you had amendments which said there has to be a core area. You know, even in the tiger reserve where the concentration is more, because, you know, they live there. You know, it was affecting their sleep patterns. It was affecting their breeding patterns. So they said, no, there are core areas which are inviolable. That means those areas, mein apna, you know, don't go into your vans and go and start clicking photos. So, you know, so there was core areas and there were buffer areas. So this is how the Wildlife Protection Act has also evolved, you know, in terms of whatever the challenges of the times were. Now, Forest Conservation Act also has a very exciting sort of genesis. Now, in Kerala, there was something called the Silent Valley Project, where in the Western Ghats, Kerala part of the Western Ghats, people wanted to set up a hydroelectric project. And they said, you know, there was a movement against it, but forest was a state subject. So though the union wanted to do something with reference to diversion of forest for the use of setting up this hydroelectric unit, they couldn't do anything because it was a state subject. So the center had an ordinance, and then it became a law because there were certain amendments, etc. So now today, under the Forest Conservation Act, no state, no entity can use the forest without prior approval of the central government. So that was really the genesis of the 1980s. It's actually a shortest law. It's barely 3 pages, but you know, it is so significant. Okay, now Environment Protection Act again has a history. Environment Protection Act came after the Bhopal disaster because they felt that whatever was the environmental regime, be it by that time, you'll see by the slide, sort of Air Act Tha, Water Act Tha, Wildlife Protection Act was there. So they felt that no, when there's a disaster of this consequence, what can the central government do? Was the present legal regime enough to tackle a disaster of this mammoth consequences with so much of human loss, etc., you know, with generations felt this loss? So that it is in the heels of the Bhopal disaster in 84 that you have the Environment Protection Act. Now, again, this is a wonderful piece of legislation on paper. We'll talk about the implementation. Now, what does this, bare bones again, what does this law say? Now, this law gives you a very important, interesting power to the central government to issue directions, right? Central government, apart from the fact that, you know, there's a violation of the law, you can go to court, the central government could issue directions under the Environment Protection Act. And in that, which is Section 5.3, etc. Now, what are the kind of directions that they've passed? What are the kind of notifications that the central government felt necessary to issue? The three prominent directions or notifications issued under this act by the central government, and which most people are fairly familiar with, is the EIA notification, which is the Environment Impact Assessment Notification of 94. Then you have to, you know, it's been amended in 2006, 2009, so on and so forth. What is this? This says that if you want to set up a project, right, you need to know the environmental implications of this project. And how will you know the environment implications of this project? You do a study, which is the environment impact assessment. Why do you do this? So that you need to know, in simple words, whether this project is reverses the environment irreversibly. You know, it destroys the environment irreversibly, or whether this project can continue side by side with the environment and you have certain mitigation measures. So each EIA will also have an environment management plan. So can you manage the consequence of this project or the implications of this project on the environment? So you have the EIA notification regime. So now you have, it's a very contested thing. Even now people would know that there are amendments and they're hugely contested. So the EIA notification was a very principal, I mean, one of the key things that these directions power under this act, you know, this was one of the key things. The second thing is the CRZ notification. What is CRZ? It's Coastal Regulation Zone notification. So what did that notification do? It protected our coasts, right? You can't now set up a huge, you know, an oil storage unit next to the beach. Tomorrow you have a cyclone. Look at the kind of damage that it's going to cost. So you have what is known as a CRZ notification, which protects the coasts coastal areas. It tells you what you can have on the coast, what kind of industries or what kind of units you can have on the coast and what you can't. And it also protects the people who live on the coast. It also tells you what are the activities that you require the coast. Like there are certain, like fishing you can't do, say in Haryana. You have to have it, you know, on the coast. So this is CRZ notification. It regulates the coastal areas. Then the third thing, the one of the most important thing, which I think is the hazardous waste management rules. So you have a lot of hazardous waste that is generated by industries. You have hospital waste, you know, you have biomedical waste. How do you dispose of this waste? How do you manage this waste? I mean, aap Ghazipur mein dekho that whole, you know, recently you must have seen it, it set itself on fire and, you know, so how do you manage this? And this is not just general waste, of course, Ghazipur is general waste, but this is hazardous waste, like asbestosis. Like for instance, ships come to be broken in India. So you have ships that come to be broken, say decommissioned ships from the European countries come to be broken in Bangladesh, in India and Pakistan. So you break it up, you sell it for scrap. So India has a huge ship breaking industry in Alang, you know. So there are a lot of release of hazardous waste. Like when you break ships, you have asbestosis, etc. So how do you, and you know, waste oil, etc. So how do you dispose of this waste? So you have the hazardous waste management rules for that. Then Water Act doesn't really have much of a history. So, but the Biological Diversity Act does. There was something called a Rio Declaration. Now, as a consequence, and I'll deal with Rio in my next slide, as a consequence of the Rio Declaration came up the Biological Diversity Act. What is interesting about this act is it talks about protection of biodiversity, which is, you know, which is plants, it could be animals, it could be microorganisms. It also talks about things like benefit sharing for the very first time, which is supposing you use certain materials from, you know, certain biological diversity you want to use, say in the production of medicine, say in the production of cosmetics, what do? You have to return to the community a certain percentage that you use to commercially use this. You know, when you take a product from a biological resource and you use it, say, to make a particular drug for commercial use, a certain percentage of this has to be given back to the community, because a lot of it is all traditional, traditional intellectual input, like haldi, whatever. I mean, I'm not going into too much detail. So Biological Diversity Act started this, you know, where there was benefit sharing and to preserve our biodiversity. There are boards, etc., set up long, you know, this, that it, in fact, one can have an entire webinar on just this act. Anyway, the next act is also, interestingly, came out of Stockholm Declaration, which is one of the first declarations on protection of environment in 1972. So India participated in this Stockholm conference, and India, just by being a mere participant, came back, and then you have the Air Act, you know, because they felt that they needed to do something back home. So all these acts have some history behind it, which you may not find necessarily in the objects and reasons when you read it. So I thought it will be an interesting input. Right. So next slide, please. Okay. So this is the Rio de Janeiro conference, United Nations Conference on Environment and Development. The next slide, please. This is an original picture, actually, which we managed to get for the webinar. Okay. I want to read this very carefully, because this principle 10 of the Rio Declaration forms a basis of several environmental principles. Okay, so I'm going to read it really carefully. Environmental issues are best handled with participation underline, of all concerned citizens at the relevant level. At the national level, each individual shall have appropriate access to information, please underline, concerning the environment that is held by public authorities, including information on hazardous materials and activities in their communities, and the opportunity to participate in the decision-making processes. States shall facilitate and encourage public awareness and participation by making information widely available. Last, effective access to judicial administrative proceedings, including redress and remedy, shall be provided. So it talked about public participation, public knowledge, information sharing. It's, in short, if you want to put it in one way, it's about environmental democracy. That no decision that will harm the environment will be taken without public information and public participation. And if they are aggrieved by anything, they have the right to access either courts or administrative bodies. So this you'll find is like a common thread in a lot of legislations and in also in a lot of the jurisprudence in India. Next slide, please. Okay, now I've tried to, now these are the core principles that have come out of Rio. Now, interestingly, when you talk about free prior informed consent, I'm going to explain this to you by way of a case law. Okay, now we had Vedanta. Okay, Vedanta, as everybody knows, is a mining company. Now, Vedanta wanted to mine bauxite in Orissa in a place, okay, on what is known as a Niyamgiri. Okay, it's a hill, right? So Vedanta wanted to go and do bauxite mining on that hill. Now, on that hill, there were several people who inhabit that hill, okay? And they are certain primitive tribal groups called the Dongriakons and the Kutiakons. Now, for centuries, they've lived on that hill. I've visited it, incidentally. They have beautiful pineapple cultivation. It's a very biodiversity-rich area. They're self-sufficient because God has been kind. It's a bountiful area in terms of natural resources, but it also has bauxite. And it's like a plateau on top. And there on the plateau, the Dongriakons and the Kutiakons are nature worshippers. Okay. Now, they believe that their god, Niyam Raja, resides on top of that plateau. Okay. So they believe that Niyam Raja resides on the top of the plateau. They worship that area. And what would bauxite mining on that hill do? Completely destroy them, destroy their habitat and everything. So Supreme Court, I'm not giving you a whole history because I have to finish my presentation in 30, 40 minutes. So what did the Supreme Court do? Supreme Court said, look, there is something called the Forest Rights Act. It's a very long act. I'm just giving you a short form. It says that, look, if you want to utilize the resources or do mining in a particular area where traditional forest dwellers live, right? And they have certain rights, including religious rights. You cannot mine that area without taking their prior informed consent, which is Gram Sabhas, which are the unit of these forest dwelling communities. That's the unit. You have to take their consent, and it has to be a free consent. It has to be a prior consent. It has to be an informed consent. Each word is so value loaded, right? So they had an external agency to see whether the Gram Sabhas in that area felt that, look, you go ahead with bauxite mining, go of our religious rights. And all the Gram Sabhas came back and said, sorry, nothing doing. These are our religious rights. We do not want bauxite mining. So Supreme Court in the OMC case, that is the Orissa Mining Corporation case, in detail talked about the Forest Rights Act and talked about the consent to be taken of Gram Sabhas. So this is, I thought it's nice to explain the concept by way of a case law. So this is what you mean when you say free, prior, informed consent. This is one example. Then public participation. What do you mean by public participation? I had earlier talked to you about environment impact assessment to be done. Now that process involves three things. That process involves in Goa. Okay, now your internet connection is unstable. Oh God. Is everybody able to hear me? Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, we can.
Okay, right. Supposing you want to set an airport, right? And this is an case on the border of Goa and Maharashtra, right? For which it is an A category industry, which means it requires an environment impact assessment to be done and a consequent environment clearance to be given to it before it starts its activity. So it had to prepare an environment impact assessment is a report that they prepare, right? Now, what do they do in that? They prepare a seasonal report, a one season report, where they see that what is the impact of the project on the environment. There are a lot of things they have to write down, like, is it close to a river? Is it close to a hill? Is it close to a wildlife sanctuary? What is the fuel that is going to generate? What is the noise that is going to generate? So it's a detailed scientific study that's done. Now, how does public participation come in? This EIA has to be placed before the public in that area. So you have to give them notice. They have to come. You have to give them a copy of the draft EIA in a language, in a vernacular language, also English, so that they understand what is the, that is for the people of that area, whether they have to understand the consequence of that report and what are their concerns. So they have to be heard. Earlier, what used to happen is they used to have a public hearing, minutes were recorded. Then they found that there was threats. They found that only people of some, vested interests were there. People of the actual community who were living there were not called. So now it has to be video recorded, the public hearing. So you have to have a public hearing where people can voice their concerns, and these concerns have to be recorded and become a part of the final EIA, which is then processed, etc. So this is when you say public participation from Rio. This is a component of public participation where their concerns have to be addressed before a consent is given finally, right? The second aspect of public participation is that every time you have a notification, which people are familiar with, I don't know, now presently the EIA notification is sought to be amended. So before it becomes, it is notified, it is opened up for public comments. So 60-day period is given to concerned people to say whether this is okay or not and what are their concerns. So this is also an element of public participation, right? Access to justice is easy. That is, if you are aggrieved by any of the environmental decisions, projects, if the laws are not being enforced, where do you go? You go to the NGT, you can go, you can exercise writ jurisdiction, you can go to 30 under 32, you can go to 226. Or if you actually want, you can also make complaints to various enforcement authorities like pollution control boards or authorities under the Air Act, Environment Protection Act, etc. So that is access to justice. So these are the three components of Rio, which have formed part of the environmental, various statutes, etc. Next slide, please. Okay. Now, interestingly, environmental laws, has several laws which are, part of environmental law. A lot of administrative law principles are part of environmental law. What are these administrative law principles? Duty to give reasons, rule against bias, acting under dictation, arbitrary action, non-application of mind. These are all generally you'll find, as law students would know if they've done administrative law, these are all administrative law principles, but they are equally applicable in the environmental jurisprudence or environmental environmental law regime. For instance, like any decision that is taken, like for instance, when a project is before an expert appraisal committee, which is before they get a clearance, it has to be placed before them. They have to give reasons why they feel that this project should go on or not. It can't be on the basis of any ipsy dixy. It has to be on the basis of rational reasons given. Rule against bias. Now, for instance, these EACs or this environment appraisal committees are headed by or are committees which have members co-opted by the government or nominated by the government, and they're experts. Like for instance, example, if you want, say, a coal mining project, it goes before the EAC. So center will have people who have expertise on this subject to look at this proposal, right? And give recommendations to the ministry saying, do we give them a pass or fail? Can they go on or not? Now, rule against bias, how does it come in? You will find, and there are actual examples, that when a mining project is for approval, you will find somebody in the EAC who is actually sitting as a director of several mining companies. So you do not want people like that who have an inherent, could have a bias. So there is a rule against bias comes in. So you can't have this sort of conflict of interest when you decide on whether these companies require, whether they should be granted clearance or not, acting under dictation. Now, EAC is to give recommendations, to the MOEF. MOEF is to decide. Finally, it's signed off by the Ministry of Environment and Forests, every clearance. So what if the minister says, "Arey, we want this project," and it's not really the administrative, the regulatary agencies who are taking this decision. So that is when acting under dictation comes in. So these principles are all used. These are actually used in cases, right? Then arbitrary action and inaction. When they don't look at, like for instance, in this Goa airport case, the project proponent who wanted to set up this airport was asked, please fill up this form called Form 1 and said, please tell us are there any rivers, are there any mountains, are there anything in this area, 15 kilometer radius of this project? And they said, no, there are no rivers, there are no mountains, there's nothing, and they believed this when this project is right next to the Western Ghats. So, you don't take into consideration, it's an arbitrary action because these are experts who are looking at it. They should know better as to where this project is situated. And finally, when they were asked to come up, when this was revisited, they found that the Western Ghats is right next door. They found 42 reserve forests in this area. For somebody who said there are hardly any forests, they found rivers, everything, so if you take decisions arbitrarily, not based on material, and there's a non-application of mind. So in general, what I want to tell you is that a lot of administrative law principles have fed into even environmental decision-making process. Okay, next slide, please. Okay, this is a very interesting slide. Okay. This talks about the Supreme Court's intervention in environmental jurisprudence. Now, at one level, long ago, much, 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 much long ago, there was this epistolary jurisdiction, which is by way of letters. People wrote letters to the Supreme Court and said, look, there is limestone mining in the Doon Valley. Do something about it. So this letter was converted to a writ petition, and then the Supreme Court passed directions. Then everybody, I think, who has some information or knowledge on environment would know about the T.N. Godavarman case. It is only 25 years old. I mean, it's as old as, my professional practice. So this is a case of 1995. And then you have the M.C. Mehta case, which is also of 1995. this is a classic case of a continuing mandamus. Continuing mandamus means continuously the Supreme Court were passing directions to the authorities to act. Now, in T.N. Godavarman case, which is like a seminal case of the Supreme Court on forests, you know, so they looked at a wide range of issues. There are, I think, thousands and thousands of IAs that have been filed. Can you imagine a litigation which has lasted for 25 years? Now, they looked at sawmills, they looked at, what are the other subjects, just give me, and they also set up what is known as a central empowered committee. So a central empowered committee was a committee which was to assist the Supreme Court, because see, many of the subjects that came to the Supreme Court required technical knowledge, required knowledge about forests, etc. So they felt that they need an agency which assists them in finally adjudicating the IAs that came before them. So they set up a central empowered committee. So a lot of reports of the CEC have been the basis of many, many cases, like even the Vedanta case or the Lafarge case. All the important cases of the Supreme Court, you'll find a CEC report, which is also there. Now they looked at, Godavarman looked at wood-based industries, they looked at social forestry, so the Kampa judgment on compensatory afforestation, they looked at national parks, sanctuaries, encroachment, mining, in forests of course. So Godavarman for 25 years are listening to IAs, even we are having presently also, we are arguing some IAs before them. So it's like a long drawn permanently doing something for the environment, and the Supreme Court has really, to give them credit, has, you know, still doing this litigation. This third aspect of what the Supreme Court deals with as of today, apart from 32, you have 32 and you have SLPs, etc., is also it's also critical appellate jurisdiction, which the Supreme Court is exercising for the last 10 years, which is appeals from the National Green Tribunal. So it's only on the substantial questions of law relating to environment, etc., that they deal with, but appeals also from NGT. I've been told I'm almost 30 minutes up. Next slide, I think I'll have to speed up. Next slide, okay. Now, interestingly, Supreme Court has four important cases which they are dealing with, which are all almost like continuous mandamus cases. One is all air pollution cases which go to the Supreme Court in terms of IAs, etc., are in the MC Mehta cases. So you have, it is also continuously, you have IAs on air pollution filed under this MC Mehta case. Forest conservation, I've told you. Then, like zoos, when you want, in the Rajaji National Park, you found that there were a lot of encroachments. How do you remove these encroachments? So everything to do with wildlife conservation were filed in this mother petition, literally, is the Center for Environmental Law. So that's the mother petition, and you have several babies, you know, IAs being filed day in and day out, but with reference to wildlife. Then on how to deal with hazardous waste, again, this is a case of continuous mandamus of the Supreme Court. You had a case of Research Foundation for Science, Technology and Ecology. So this dealt with how do you deal with hazardous waste, including ship breaking, waste oil, how to dispose of waste. So a lot of IAs were continuously filed in this litigation. So these are four examples of the continuous mandamus jurisdiction of the Supreme Court. Next slide, please. Okay, this is actually very important. I want to tell you one thing. In the first slide, it's a very, very, very important thing. What happened was when in the 1980s, you had the Forest Conservation Act. Now, what happened was that permissions to use forest for non-forest use was only of government recorded forests. So what happened was that permissions were taken only where in the government records it is termed as forest. Uske liye bas permission lete the under the Forest Conservation Act. So large parts of forests which were, say, maybe in the records were revenue, but if you go and see, it's just like rich forests, and lots of forests which were outside the records were left out, and no permission was sought to use those forests for non-forest use. And Supreme, this 1980 Act is literally failing. So they stepped in, and this is one of the most important orders passed, which is significant even today, is the 12-12-1996 order, where Supreme Court said, forest, I'll read it, forest must be understood in terms of the dictionary meaning and applies to all categories of forest, irrespective of ownership and classification. So they introduced the dictionary meaning of forest, said, nay, it's not just what is recorded, and then set up committees in every state, set up committees saying, please go to your states, look at what is, you know, what land landscape constitutes forests, and come back to it. That significant thing, when forest was defined as dictionary meaning of forest, that lest I'll leave because I'll speed up my slides. Next slide, please. Okay, now finally, this is the third segment, which is what are the principles of environment jurisprudence, which is sustainable development. Everybody would have heard of it. Principle of absolute polluter pays, precautionary principle, doctrine of public trust, and many more. But these are some of the most significant ones. Next slide, please. Okay. Now, I want to explain the public trust doctrine to you by this case, which is one of the first cases which spoke about public trust. Of course, it's a borrowed concept, you know, England and then America's, it doesn't matter. We borrow and it's here to stay. Now, look at this slide. This is, interestingly, it's a Span Resort and Spa. Now, you will see the beautiful Bias River on the side of this resort. So what did Span Resort do? You know, it actually tried to change the course of this river so that their resort can be set up, etc. So then court stepped in and said, sorry, I mean, state has failed. Resort has failed. And they said, you can't, you know, state, next slide, actually. State, I'll just, yeah, sorry. Yeah, they said that it, state holds natural resources in public trust. You can't allow individuals to play around with nature in this way, like actually changing the course of the river. So I'll read this. Our legal system based on English common law includes the public trust doctrine as part of its jurisprudence. The state is the trustee of all natural resources, which are by nature meant for public use and enjoyment. So you can't let an individual for his private gain change the course of the river. The state as a trustee is under a legal duty to protect the natural resources. These resources are meant for public use and cannot be converted into private ownership. So this was a very, very significant environmental law principle which was laid down in this M.C. Mehta versus Kamal Nath's case. And, you know, and so whatever, the, you know, he was penalized, and whatever was the illegal construction, etc., trying to change the course, all that was taken out, etc. So this is a success story, but it's also the beginning of the public trust doctrine in India. Now, this doctrine also has evolved. You know, now this is what, 97. So we are in 2020. So let's look at the evolution. Next slide, please. Okay, now in the CEL case, they developed this principle. They took it a step forward. What did they say? The state as a custodian of natural resources has a duty to maintain them not only for the benefit of the public, but for the best interest of flora and fauna and wildlife and so on. So they said it's not just, you know, these resources for public use, but for the benefit of the wildlife itself. So not just human benefit, right? It also extended this principle of public trust. Next slide, please. Okay, then they further, this is of course the spectrum case where there was a special reference. Now they took it, they came up with something else in this judgment, again on public trust. They said, public trust doctrine does not prohibit alienation of natural resources held on public trust by the state for commercial exploitation by private persons. Public trust doctrine provides for a high degree of judicial scrutiny of any action of the state when you allocate national, because it can't be that you cannot allocate at all. You do allocate, but the scrutiny, judicial scrutiny, has to be of the highest degree when you do it, because the state holds it in public trust. Okay, next slide, please. Okay, this is very interesting. Everybody must be familiar with this, people from Tamil Nadu especially. This is Jallikattu. Now, Jallikattu is bullock cart racing, etc. This is it was a very contentious issue. They said for centuries, people in Tamil Nadu are doing this bullock cart racing and various games related to bullock cart racing, etc. Now, Supreme Court stepped in and said, sorry, you know, one is to use animals for necessity, and one is when you use it for your pleasure. This is avoidable pain. You know, this is a pain caused to the animals which could be avoided, which is for your pleasure. So therefore, they laid down certain very important principles in this case. Next slide, please. Okay, they said, the court has also a duty under the doctrine of parens patriae to take care of animals, since they are unable to take care of themselves as against human beings. The state becomes the parent of these animals because they can't take care. You know, the human voice is there. What about their voice? So they said the courts have to step in. Next slide, please. Okay. This is a very, very important principle. Again, it's a newer principle. Not many people, everybody knows polluter pays, sustainable development. But this is an interesting principle, which is species best interest standard. They said every species has an inherent right to live and shall be protected by law, subject to the exceptions provided out of necessity. That's what I was telling you. Animal also has honor and dignity, which cannot be arbitrarily deprived, and its rights and privacy have to be respected and protected from unlawful attack. So they raised the bar, you know, with reference to animal protection. Interestingly, I always crack a joke. You know, the right to privacy for us came in 2017, I think. And then for the animals, it was in 2014. So this is a very interesting principle. And all this whole, you know, a few years of having Justice Radhakrishnan, you know, part of the Supreme Court, was a godsend to us. And, you know, I am his biggest fan, and all the judgments of Justice Radhakrishnan have beautifully and succinctly, you know, has enlarged the scope of environmental jurisprudence in this country. Okay, next. These are all his judgments, by the way. Okay, next. Even this is his judgment. Now, ecocentric principle. Can you go back here? Now, before I start, tell you about this principle, I'll tell you about the facts of this case. It's very interesting. You would have, I don't know if you've heard of it, but India houses in Gujarat, in Gir, it houses the Asiatic lions. Now, the Asiatic lions were there in different parts of the world, but they've all vanished. So the only subpopulation of this beautiful species called the Asiatic lion is there only in one region of India, which is in Gujarat, in and around Gir forests and Girnar forests. So, and I think it's about 200, 300, or I'm not very sure about the numbers. So that is the only existing population of the Asiatic lion in the whole world. So we went to court and we said, look, you just need one wildfire. You need one, canine distemper virus, and the entire species is wiped out. So we went to court. I was part of this litigation, incidentally. We went to court and we said, look, we need a second home for these species, right? We need another home for the survival of this species, which is only found in India, and to protect them so that if they have a second home, you'll have like another subpopulation somewhere else. So a lot of studies were done and they found that there was a place in Madhya Pradesh in Kuno, which could house the Asiatic lion and be a second home to these Asiatic lions. So in that context, in that judgment, and finally the court agreed and said, yes, you need to relocate lions from Gir in Gujarat to Kuno in Madhya Pradesh for its survival of the species as a whole. And then they coined a very interesting principle called the ecocentric principle. I'm going to read this. It says, ecocentrism is nature-centered, where humans are a part of nature, but non-humans have intrinsic value. In other words, human interest does not take automatic precedence, and humans have obligations to non-humans independently of human interest. Ecocentrism is therefore life-centered, nature-centered, where nature includes both humans and non-humans. Next slide, please. Okay, then, right, this, I'm repeating this. I think you can leave this slide. Next slide, please. Right, this, of course, most people are familiar with. I'll just quickly read it. I don't need to spend too much time. It's the polluter pays principle, and it's been interpreted in Vellore, where there were tanneries in Tamil Nadu, and then they were causing so much of water pollution, and they had to go to court, and the Vellore Citizens Forum went to court. And at that time, it was a very new doctrine, you know, and they borrowed from tort law, etc. What it says is the polluter pays principle, as interpreted by the Supreme Court, means that absolute liability for harm to the environment extends not only to compensate the victims. So victims are not the only, but also the cost of restoring the environmental degradation. So it's not like, oh, you've caused harm to a person, you just compensate him. No, you compensate the environment in restoring it. So polluter pay is not just, A to B, right? The next slide, please. Next slide, please. Oh, is it, was there a slide previous to this, which I missed? I think. Oh, no, sorry. Yeah, go ahead. Next slide, please. Yeah. The polluter, is it pay and pollute? Yeah. The polluter pay principle basically means the producer of goods and other items should be responsible. So now this is a third element. First element was if you directly caused pollution and somebody has been affected, like say fumes are being emanated out of an industry, people are fainting, like it happened in Delhi, school children were affected, so you directly pay them. That's one component. Second is you restore the environment. So you pay for the compensation to restoring the environment. The third is, please see, this is very important, should be responsible for the cost of preventing or dealing with any pollution that the process causes. So you even, because of certain processes are inherently, could cause pollution, lead, even for prevention, you have to pay. So it's not just polluter, who can pay, pollute and pay for it. Right, next slide, please. The precautionary principle, again, everybody is familiar with it. I'll quickly read it. This principle generally describes an approach to the protection of environment or human health based around precaution, not wait for something to happen. Even when there is no clear evidence of harm or risk of harm from an activity or substance, it is a part of the principle of sustainable development It provides for taking protection against specific hazards by avoiding or reducing environmental risks before the specific harms are experienced. So in many cases of environment, you don't wait for something to happen. So many times when you know what are the likely impacts, you take steps, right? So this is a very, very important principle of environment jurisprudence. Next slide, please. Okay, I don't know how much time we have. How much time do we have? Because then I'll just leave all this and go to my last segment.
Now we still have time. You may please continue.
Yeah, okay. This is a judgment which is known as the MOPA judgment, which is where there was an airport to be set up in Goa and Goa border of Goa and Maharashtra, which is a very interesting and a very important judgment of Hanuman Lakshman Aroskar, which is where the entire EIA notification connecting EIA and sustainable development goals. This judgment also talks about environmental rule of law, and it has some very important paragraphs as to how you can treat the environment. You can't be casual about it. And I want to read some paras, if I may do so. The first one says, there can be no gambles with environment. A heads I win, tails you lose approach is unacceptable. Unacceptable if we are to preserve environmental governance under the rule of law. Next slide, please. Okay, these were the judges who rendered this judgment. And you know, what is important is they say, you know, because state of Goa had given incorrect information, you know, while the project was to be assessed. And they said that we cannot gloss over the patent and abject failure of the state of Goa as the project proponent in failing to disclose, you know, so they had not disclosed wetlands, water sources, water bodies, biospheres, mountains, forests within an aerial distance of 15 kilometers is required by Form 1. The disclosure in Form 1 constitutes the very foundation of the, next slide, please. Oh, it's gone off. Anyway, doesn't matter. They talked about how if you want to, sorry, no, it's okay. It doesn't matter. You can go to the third slide. Yes. Yeah, this one. See, what it did is that it also said that how, you know, you can't get an environmental clearance by giving false information. You know, you can't treat environment so lightly. States were pulled up saying that, look, I'm sorry, if you want to do the process, you have to do it rigorously. You can't do it casually. And the ill effects are far too much. Then they also said, they found that environmental rule of law becomes a priority, particularly when we acknowledge that the benefits of environment rule of law extend far beyond the environmental sector. Because they felt that, look, this is very important. While the most direct effects are on the protection of environment, it also strengthens the rule of law. More broadly, it supports sustainable economic and social development. It protects public health. So whenever you are talking about environment and environmental implications, it's not just on the environment, right? It's on public health. It's on socioeconomic development. It contributes to peace and security. It diffuses conflict, because when you take people along with you in the process of environmental decision making, you have lesser hartals, you have lesser social unrest, and it protects human and constitutional rights. You know, right to be a part of it, right to clean environment, right? So it is, whenever you talk about environmental decisions, they're not only felt on the environment. That is what the judgment says, right? Next slide, please. Okay, I think we'll just leave this. Okay, one principle is there actually, I'm sorry. Okay, it says, you know, I want to just talk about the last line in this. The intertwined concepts of environmental rule of law thus further intra-generation as well as intergenerational equity. because we have sustainable development is a principle which says that our impacts should not be such that tomorrow our children cannot enjoy the fruits of the environment. So when you talk about dealing with environment and sustainable development, you have to take care of the future generations also. Your projects cannot be only looked at for whatever is the benefit of the present generation. Next slide, please. Okay, I just leave all this. Go to the next one. Right. Now, we've talked about the Supreme Court intervention. They have dealt with public trust. They've dealt with polluter pays. They've dealt with sustainable development. They've dealt with species best interest. They've dealt with parents patriae. But high courts have also not been so far behind. High courts have also stepped in, and I've given you just some illustrative cases. I don't know if people are familiar. Rivers is living entity. Okay, this is also a fairly controversial judgment from Uttarakhand High Court. What it says is that all rivers in Uttarakhand, Gangotri, Yamunotri, brooks, rivers, forests, trees, everything are living entities. So they have a right to sue, right to be sued. They have fundamental rights. And they made the Advocate General of the state, they made Mr. M.C. Mehta, who's the third person? M.C. Mehta, the Advocate General, and I'm forgetting one more person. They made all of them, to be people who have to look after the interest of trees, etc., and fight for them. So it's a very interesting thing. They've equated all things in nature. They've given it, they've made them legal entities. Of course, this is challenged and it's pending before the Supreme Court now. The next judgment is about access and benefit sharing. This is probably the only judgment, again, from the Uttarakhand High Court. It's a beautifully reasoned, wonderful judgment, but one of the only judgments on the Biodiversity Act. Right now, this was a case where Divya Pharmacy wanted to use certain biological resources for medicinal Ayurvedic purposes. And a notice was issued to Divya Pharmacy saying that, look, you have taken some biological resources to use it in your product, which you will market commercially. So you have to give a percentage of that to the people, the traditional people who have used this knowledge and this, who have protected these resources. So Divya Pharmacy went to court and said, sorry, we will not do any benefit sharing with anybody. It is only applicable to foreign entities. Indians don't have to share a part of this benefit. And so the court said nothing doing. Even Indians have to. So this is a beautiful case where you have to share benefits. And it's, I think, 0.1 to 0.5% of what you make. You have to share, give back. This is a principle of giving back to the community whose knowledge you have used in making your Ayurvedic products or what have you. Then the other one, which is very, very contested, presently pending litigations, are the draft EIA notification challenges, which are pending in Madras, in Karnataka, and in the Delhi High Court. And it's stuck on a very interesting point. As I told you earlier, that every notification, before it becomes a notification, the draft notification is circulated to the public for public comments, right? So they wanted, because of the pandemic, they wanted an extension in time to give public comments. But interestingly, when they went to court, they said, look, you have given us this only in English and Hindi. We are a diverse country which speaks so many languages. Unless we understand this notification and it's accessible to us, how are we going to give our comments? So the Delhi High Court said, look, sorry, at least in the 22 languages which are there in the 8th schedule, you have to translate it. I mean, it's not yet done. So In Tamil Nadu also, they said you have to translate it into Tamil. They said Karnataka, Kannada. You can't see. It can't be an empty formality that you can't expect everybody length and breadth of India to speak English and Hindi and understand it. So sorry, if you want to make it meaningful, translate it. Okay, so these are litigations that are pending. Then the last one is again very interesting, which is there was a highway project in, you know, you'll see the whole Bharatmala project, set of projects, and you have huge highways being 4-lane, 6-lane, God knows what, you know. So the EIA notification says, if you want to expand the highway, you need to take an environment impact assessment needs to be done, and you need to take an environment clearance, right? Now, but they gave an exception. They said if the expansion is above 100 kilometers, only then you require an environment clearance, otherwise you don't. So what did NHAI do? It split the project. Though it was 270 kilometers of expansion, they made it into four segments. And they said, array, four segments constructed by different people, concessionaires. So we don't need an EIA because it all comes under 50, I mean, under 100 kilometers. Court said, sorry, you can't segment it. EIA is far too important a decision-making tool that you cannot segment or break this road on the basis of concessionaire to avoid doing an environment impact assessment, which is absolutely necessary when you do road widening expansion of this nature. So that is now pending before the Supreme Court, but the High Court rendered a finding in favor of the people who went and said you can't segment. Right, next slide, please. Okay, this I have, this I've already dealt with. Next. Okay, this was actually Ramdev's case, Baba Ramdev's Divya Pharmacy in the benefit sharing. Next case, next slide, please. Okay, the last slide, the next slide, please. This is the NGT, the building of the NGT. Now, I can't finish my presentation without talking about the NGT, which came up, which was an act of 2010. It's been 10 years since the NGT. Now, what is so special about the National Green Tribunal? What does it do? Now, if you look at 32 petitions or 226 petitions, they look at the decision-making process. So they do what is known as judicial review, right? Have the decisions that have been taken, say, by environmental agencies correct? Have they followed the process? Was there quorum, etc.? But they do not look at the correctness of the decision. You understand? They look at only the legality of the decision. Or rather, to put it very simply, they look at the decision-making process and not the decision itself. But the NGT has two jurisdictions. They do what is known as not just judicial review, they also do merit review, which means if supposing somebody is constructing a dam, right? You are not just going to see that whether the committee had all the members, whether all the information pertaining to the dam was circulated, whether their decision was on the basis of application of mine. But NGT can even tell you whether the dam height should be X or Y. So the very decision, because that's why NGT has not just judicial members, they have expert members in the field of science, they have field of zoology, botany, etc., etc. So they have professors who are expert members. So you have, it's a combination. So you have judicial members and expert members. And so therefore, this is a very critical component, merit review. So they can look at the decision on merits, not just the decision-making process. So they have merit review and judicial review. They're not bound strictly by CPC. They have liberal locus standi. So not just the person affected. There's a very big difference between person aggrieved and person affected. So you don't need to be affected directly by pollution. You don't have to be staying in that area. It's not necessary if you participated in the public hearing or not, even if you're tangentially affected. Because if you look at our fundamental duties, every citizen has a right to go and want free and clean environment, right? So they have given an extended and a liberal meaning to locus standi, and anybody who's aggrieved, it says any person, group, aggrieved can go. So it's a very broad thing, right? Okay, I think I'm just, do I have time for another 2 minutes?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Okay, next slide, please. Right. Now, my key concerns are this, and I'll do it really quickly. My key concerns are when technological decisions are taken by courts, like for instance, in the writ jurisdiction, like under 32, etc. According to me, that's not really a correct thing because, you know, they should be taken by the executive. Like when Supreme Court decided to say that you should have smog towers. Now, smog towers is a failed technology in many parts of the world. But then they felt that, no, I can understand the concern from which they come from. They feel concerned about the air pollution. So they said, have smog towers. But these technological solutions from the courts, by courts, is a bit of a question mark. The other thing, very interesting concern, is NIMBY. I don't know if anybody has heard of NIMBY, which in simple terms means not in my backyard. So Delhi decides that, look, all diesel vehicles which are more than 10 years old, please don't ply them in Delhi. But what happens? They plied in Gwalior. So we don't want to have a thermal power plant or a polluting industry in Delhi. But yes, we don't mind it in Raigad, Raipur, Korba. So the principle is not in my backyard. This can't work. You know, your solution can't be that you shift everything, say, because everything is very NCR focused, unfortunately. You know, you can't say, oh, we'll just shift the pollution to another place. That can't be. This not in my backyard business can't work. You have to go for cleaner technologies. You have to see that environmental norms are fulfilled. You need to have stringent implementation. Don't just shift it out of, let's shift it out of Delhi. You know, that can't be, so NIMBY is actually a very famous principle, because a lot of NIMBY happened when Europe decided, look, we don't want to break ships in, we'll have the ship, we'll use it. But after decommissioning, we don't want to break it in Europe. It's too polluting. Let's send it to Bangladesh, India, Pakistan. So it's like they don't want the pollution to happen there. But they use the resources. They use the benefits. But the brunt of this thing is borne by somebody else. So NIMBY can't be happening. It's really a key concern. Then judicial activism is a seasonal issue. I'll just leave all this. This is basically what I mean is that jaise hi Delhi ka hawa kharab hota hai in October, November, you'll suddenly see a spate of IAs. Please stop, the burning of thing in Punjab, husk, etc. Do this, have this, don't have crackers. So it's a very seasonal approach. You know, you'll have IAs only in the winter, and then come summer, people just forget, those IAs just disappear. So let's not have a seasonal activism when it comes to environment. It's a 24/7, 365 days of a year issue. Okay, then complete lack of enforcement. I can't deal with it. We're running short of time, but there has been, it's apathetic and unfortunate that enforcement is extremely, extremely poor. And there has been abject failure of pollution control boards and, all in fact, across the board, except maybe forest offenses. There are a lot of bookings of forest offenses, but under Air Act, Water Act, etc., there's negligible enforcement. And that's also leading to, higher level of pollutions. Next slide, please. Okay, now this is something I just couldn't end. This is the last final segment. I could not end without talking about climate change implications, Now, what is, I've just sort of taken some quotes. Okay, now warming of 3 or 3.5 degrees would unleash suffering beyond anything that humans have ever experienced. Now just look at this. Hotter, wetter days on the horizon for India as latest climate report sends stark warning. Temperature in India could rise by 4.4 by so-and-so, says government report. Now, a failure to reduce greenhouse gas emissions will increase the likelihood of heat waves, droughts, and cyclonic activity heavily impacting India's natural ecosystem. We've already seen it. I'm sure all of you are aware, if you look at the number of cyclones, number of floods, Amphan, Nira, every day, I mean, even in Bangalore, it was flooded. So climate change is here, folks. I mean, it's time somebody did something. And next slide, please. You know, no human has ever lived on a planet as hot as this one, and it will get hotter. Just 2 degrees increase in temperature will lead to 2 meters increase in sea level, enough to drown Shanghai, Hong Kong, Mumbai, and Calcutta. These are all, I mean, I've taken it out from several books of people who've written on climate change. The next slide, please. Okay, now this is how climate change will, a new study projects that in the absence of quick and significant action, Mumbai in 2050 will look much like what it did in the 1700s, with the sea having reclaimed much of the landfill that the city has been built on. Next slide, please. Okay, now this is out of drowning. I just want to read the last slide because it pertains to women, and women are, even in climate change, women are going to be impacted much more because of climate change impacts. Because, you know, it was very interesting. They found that during cyclone disasters in Bangladesh, 90% of the 140,000 people who died were women, because a lot of women don't know how to swim, you know, and there are other reasons, because they don't go out, they're always in one place. So when there are floods, they are drowned. So, you know, there's a huge, there's a lot more to be said. I know I'm cutting it short, but I don't have time. The next slide, please. Okay, now the last, my concerns are these. You know, the seriousness of an enormity of climate change is yet to figure in judicial decisions. My fear also is that there's a dominance of judicial review as opposed to merit review. Cases are largely relating to pollution, deforestation, urban planning, etc. Judicial decisions have not kept pace with the threat of climate change. Now, Paris Agreement, I just want to tell you what Paris Agreement says, 2015, which everybody talks about. It basically, the central aim of Paris Agreement was to strengthen global response. So the threat of climate change by keeping a global temperature rise in this century below 2 degrees Celsius. So the global rise, they wanted to keep it below 2 degrees Celsius, was the Paris Agreement among states. But unfortunately, the implications of Paris Agreement and the rising global temperatures, etc., are not featuring in as much as it's required in judicial decision making. My endeavor is that it will, hopefully, you know, one should always be optimistic, but the environment is a common fight, my friends. I mean, everybody has to step in and do something. Please do whatever you can, be it conserve water, don't use plastics. Every single person can do something. It is our environment, and we all, it's a common goal for all of us. I thank you very, very much for being so patient. I know I've just spoken on and on. I've crossed all time thresholds, but thank you very much. Thank you, Professor, and thank you, Mayuri.
Thank you, ma'am. It was a pleasure hearing you. And if you, with your permission, we may take question and answer questions now.
Yes.
I would like to bring to the notice of the participants that we also are open for the live questions. So those who would like to ask the live question, please just raise your hand and we'll allow you to ask the question.
Okay.
So we'll take the live questions first. Mayuri ma'am, is that okay? Yes, Ms. Charvi, please unmute yourself and ask the question.
All right. Good afternoon, sir, and good afternoon, ma'am. Oh my gosh, this was such a revelation, just hearing everything. I don't think I studied international environmental law, I've taught it, but I did not know 1% of what you have taught today. So I'm just really grateful to you. And so, ma'am, I actually have two questions from you, and with your permission, they're sort of...
Yeah, please.
So I think the first thing that I want to discuss is you talked about how the Supreme Court, you know, engages in this seasonal sort of activism when it comes to air pollution. And I was thinking, have they also done that in the case of animal rights, like where they have had the chance to maybe do more, they have stepped back? I mean, for example, I was in law school when they said that, you know, bullocks have dignity and, oh my gosh, it made waves all over the world, right, in the animal rights sphere. And then the Tamil Nadu government brought up an amendment which allowed Jallikattu to resume, and people tried to file applications challenging it, and the Supreme Court just dismissed it and said, go to the state high court. Except it's not just Tamil Nadu that has Jallikattu. There are other states who do different versions of bullock cart racing.
Yes,
and I feel like, do you think that the Supreme Court has paid lip service, but in the end not done enough or not really stood up? And this would also bring me to the question of leather, for example. It really damages the environment. And I don't see how it's a necessity for us to wear animal skin on our bodies or use them as handbags. So has the Supreme Court just paid lip service and then just decided to turn its head around and say, okay, now we've said this, but now you continue with whatever you're doing?
See, Charvi, I'm very, very happy when, you know, you say that this has been informative for you, because, I was just telling my junior this morning that this is the last webinar I'm going to do, because, you know, this, but when you say things like this, that it's helpful, I feel very, I feel good. I'm glad I'm able to do something and disseminate whatever little I've learned, you know, in the profession, and to share it with you. I'm grateful. I hope it's useful. Charvi, see, the thing is also, unfortunately, it's also, you know, you have judges who have inclinations. So that's why when I said, even when you had Justice Radhakrishnan, he had a certain environmental bent, you know. So you do have this. I mean, you have judges who take on certain subjects. And that time, you know, that there was also a time when Bodhavarman, they weren't called green benches, but we had regular sittings of green benches, you know, in the Supreme Court, like Friday afternoons, you know, all the Bodhavarman IAs would be listed. And there were, at one point of time, there were two benches which heard only these green matters, so to speak. And it also depends on individual judge to judge. I understand it is heartbreaking, because once you, give a seminal judgment, you lay down such principles and then you send it back. I know it's the pullback. But, you know, it also depends on, you know, how much of an interest they have in a particular subject, you know. Well, we have to live with it. I mean, Supreme Court will have all sorts of judges, some brilliant, you know, you have, it's a mixed bag, you know. Yeah. I can't say anything much.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you so much. Again, I didn't know about the green benches, and it did.
And they were wonderful judges. So they actually had dedicated time slots, you know. And I think that made a big difference, because, you know, when you know one Friday afternoon, you're going to deal with it. And because every case that came, say even before the Godavarman bench, were of different subjects. So even they got enlightened in the process, and definitely Justice Radhakrishnan had a very favorable bent. And so this series of judgments came during his time.
All right, ma'am. So there is hope then, I guess.
Yeah, you just have to hope, do your bit, and there's a lot you can do, you know, anybody. Okay. Yeah. And all the best to you. All the very best.
And ma'am, okay, so one more question, and this has something to do with the Paris Climate Agreement. So again, there were all these news outlets, I think a couple of weeks ago, that were saying India is the only G20 nation which is going to achieve and in fact overachieve its goals for 2050 under the Paris Agreement. And yet the pollution is getting worse, our emissions are increasing, our sinks are depleting, like you have explained in great detail. And I did not know this, but after today, I am terrified because you're saying that while the world might only encounter a change of 2.1 degrees Celsius, we are going to maybe encounter a change of 4 degrees Celsius.
And these are all, I have not relied on any newspaper. I mean, only for some of them are newspaper, but most of them are all research papers and, you know, may not have given sources, but from David Wallace's book, etc., you know, on climate change. It is, I mean, I don't know. There could be a huge, according to me, very frankly, there's an information lag from what we see and what is presented is my personal opinion on this.
Right. And ma'am, even the climate change tracker, the actual website, it says that yes, India is going to meet its goals, but that's only because we have not been ambitious enough. And do you think in that case, overall, do you think our climate jurisprudence has failed? Or has at least stagnated? I feel
you
like
being a practicing lawyer, I won't. I'll just be very diplomatic. you know, I'm no one to give a report card. But yes, for 25 years, I've also done environmental litigation. So there are highs and lows. Let me just leave it at that.
Okay, ma'am. Okay, thank you so much, ma'am. That was very informative. Thank you.
Ms. Shagun. Sapru, please unmute yourself and ask your question. Ms. Shagun? Okay, we'll take it to Dr. Madhukar. Please unmute yourself and ask.
Yes, sir. Good morning, sir. Good morning, ma'am and everyone. Ma'am, I have two questions, and both the questions pertain to environmental criminal law. Like we know that we have the EPA, APA, and WPA for more than 3 decades. And though we have developed the environmental law jurisprudence, but that is on the civil side. We have not developed environmental criminal law jurisprudence. So do you think so that the picture would have been different if the criminal law jurisprudence in respect of environment would have developed in last 3 decades?
You are absolutely right. Absolutely right. There is an abject failure because if you look at it, one and a half years is the punishment under the Air and Water Act with fines. I don't know if anybody's ever gone to jail under Air Act, Water Act, you know. And except, I must be honest, I don't have the figures right now, but forest offenses, there are a lot of bookings. And there is some environmental jurisprudence, I mean, connecting it to criminal law in poaching cases, you will find. In poaching, in hunting, in under the WPA, there are a lot of cases. And there are also, you know, things are being sent to China, you have the CITES, etc. There is some development of criminal law jurisprudence. And yes, I agree with you, Madhukar ji, you're bang on right. If it was, it would have acted as a deterrent. You send somebody to jail, I mean, they wouldn't have, but it's with impunity people pollute, you know, they don't care. I've seen it, it's very unfortunate.
Ma'am, subsequent question is this, that one of the report that is available with SLS Noida, and that is completely a statistical report that says that during 2 decades from 1992 year 2010 till the year 2010, across 400 districts in India, nearly around 2000 criminal cases under the EPA, APA and WPA were registered. So, no doubt that this is a very poor figure. But at the same time, the other fact is that our courts are already overburdened with the human conflict. So what do you think when there is a question before the court that should we settle the human-animal conflict or human-environment conflict or the human-human conflict? Which of the two should be prioritized by the courts?
You know, interestingly, can I just tell you that before I answer the second segment, ma'am. जो आपने जो स्टेटिस्टिक दिया है वो कौन से साल का है?
मैम फ्रॉम द ईयर 1990 टू 2010.
Oh, this is a very old statistic. You know, because I was recently looking at a statistic which said that there's an increase in the number of cases under the Air Act and Water Act. And it's actually because they have booked a lot of cases for people who smoke in public. And so the numbers have increased. But for setting up industries which pollute, etc., you know, under the Air Act or emitting fumes, etc., those cases are still very abysmal. And I've looked at the NCRB data, you know, but even then, even if you look at 2000, it's still quite low, isn't
yes,
it, Madhukar ji?
Ma'am, with NCRB, may I continue, ma'am?
Yeah, the second part of your query is that, you know, they look, if we don't have environment, now we won't have human-human conflict also. I mean, a court should realize that in the situation that we live in, we are intrinsically linked to our environment. And if there is no environment, there's going to be no us. So, you know, it's time they looked at these issues, you know, on priority.
Yes, ma'am. May I continue, ma'am?
Yeah, please, please.
Ma'am, you were talking about some data on the wildlife offenses, something like that.
Yeah.
Data is also available with SLS Noida report, which says that during last decade, I mean to say from the year 2005 to the year 2015,
right,
across 165 forest divisions, around 1600 cases were registered under the Wildlife Protection Act. So, ma'am, even though that data says that conviction rate is almost similar to the conviction rate of other offenses that are tried by the court. So, what we could see is that that it is not because that there is failure on part of the magistracy that we have failed to control or contain the environment-related offenses, but the reason could be something else. Because when the conviction rate is almost similar to other offenses, so we are trying to look out, or what do you suggest, ma'am, that we should increase, we should enhance or increase the conviction rate with respect to the environment-related offenses as well?
Yes. I mean, I don't get the question. Madhukar ji, are you a forest officer?
No, ma'am. I am a teacher at SLS Noida.
SLS is Symbiosis Law.
SLS Noida, yes, ma'am.
Oh, how wonderful.
I am teaching here.
Oh, lovely. What do you teach, Professor?
Ma'am, I am teaching criminal procedural law.
Oh, I see. That's why your questions. Now I get you. Yeah. So, okay, fair enough. So obviously there's some lag somewhere. I mean, I can't give you an answer, you know, in terms of why, though the magistracy is strong, number of cases are strong, why they're failing convictions. I mean, I can only say maybe the investigation and trial stages, it's not done properly. That's just a general guess, Madhukar ji. I really can't give you a...
Yes.
You know, there's really lack of will on everybody's part. You know, the agencies don't care and the polluter doesn't care. And the general public, as I said, when the pollution becomes too much, they care. And then when the pollution levels go down, they don't care. So, you know, it's sad. I mean, it requires like a huge movement where people realize that, look, it's really, you know, the path is very dangerous from now on. You know, that jab tak they don't understand it from within and make it a movement, you know, I don't know how things are going to improve, really. One can only do one's best at an individual level, which we are all doing, I'm sure.
Yes, ma'am. So nice. So thank you, ma'am.
You know, thank you. Thank you so much. I didn't know. Yes, I mean, other professors are listening in. Oh, God. Right. Next question.
Mr. Piroz Pathan, please unmute yourself and ask your question.
Yes. Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning.
I'd like to ask the Paris Accord was the product of UNFCCC, that is United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change.
Right.
that had by the accord and the signing countries, that is common but differentiated responsibility. That was the basis of Paris Agreement, that all the countries in the world do have a common responsibility so far as environment is concerned.
Right.
But they have differential responsibility because the kind of industrial development that
Absolutely.
Has taken place in developing countries and the kind of industrial production that has taken place in developed countries, that has, a difference of leaps and bounds.
Right.
But so far as our efforts for that matter regarding the environment protection is concerned as a country, or for that matter, the global efforts regarding protection of environment are concerned, I do feel genuinely that there is something called fire dosing mode. Because whatever the nature of government we have, that changes eventually, and the climate policies, the climate this thing related efforts and initiatives also do change, as we saw it in case of USA, that when Trump regime came, they were absolutely reluctant to adopt the climate initiatives.
Yeah.
So far as India is concerned, when you have rightly discussed that in a lot of cases, the Supreme Court the judiciary in general has been proactive so far as protection is concerned. But continuing mandamus has been used by judiciary only when the cases came up before them. And when it comes to general public, it was in a way or two taken as a judicial order. When NGT decides what should be the height of a dam. To in a particular region, that is judicial authority. So I come from the fact that in case judiciary steps in, so far as promotion of low carbon technology is concerned, or so far as the direction to the government is concerned regarding steps to be taken, so far as budget towards climate research is concerned, budget towards climate policies is concerned, because that is somewhere lagging in India. We don't have budget specific towards climate research or towards climate policy. So in case tomorrow judiciary steps in on a suo motu basis and it issues instructions to the government in power at center or for that matter state government, that these are the steps you are supposed to take. Like for industries also, they can have suo motu instructions regarding what kind of technology is supposed to be produced on their part. Like it's clean power technology or say low
FGD, etc.
carbon technology. Don't you think so? Yeah. So what is your opinion?
So your fear is that when the government, when the courts step in, it's taken as judicial overreach. Whereas, according to you, the court should step in, especially when it comes to climate change related matters and the implementation of the Paris Agreement. And it shouldn't be taken as a policy decision, and they should have a more hands-on approach rather than a hands-off approach. Is that what you're saying? Is that your question?
Because even courts approach it, even courts approach it in fire dosing mode. It can be considered as a fire dosing mode. Continuing mandamus, in whatever cases court has taken up, those cases had come up before the court, and it is.
Yeah, very, you're right. You're saying that suo motu they should. Yeah, sorry, Firoz.
No, please continue. So thing is that, ma'am, what I'm expecting is that court no doubt steps in, but court is not stepping in so far as the government machinery is concerned. Court steps in only, regarding issuing instructions to, say. Car manufacturers, truck manufacturers.
Yeah, so what you're saying is that they're more reactionary. There are no instructions given to the executive. Rather, it is to individuals and industries who come. So they're not proactive, according to
you. Yes. So far as judiciary's role is concerned, in issuing instructions to executive is concerned, how do you see, the approach in last 5 years? Has it changed or not? Because I'm not in judiciary right now, or for that matter, in litigation. So what is the change in approach?
So what do you do, Firoz? Firoz ji, what do you do? You're a lawyer?
Ma'am, budding. No, no, no. I'm a budding lawyer, actually. I mean,
you're a budding lawyer. Excellent.
Yeah.
Very good. I mean, I'm very impressed. Firoz, well, I can't tell you, you're right. In some cases, the Supreme Court has stepped in, may not be necessarily in environmental matters. And you're right in the sense that they've stepped in mainly related to, you know, pollution, and it's been more reactionary rather than proactive. That could be. I mean, it could be. But I'm not able to get, what are you saying, that Supreme Court should be more proactive and issue instructions?
Have they been proactive so far as executive is concerned? I mean, what is your...
Yeah, they, of course, they have been proactive, whereas the executive is concerned. I mean, in all these continuing mandamus cases, it's not just directions issued to individuals, but also in directions issued to state governments. The chief secretaries are called, even in this pollution matter, you know, with reference to stubble burning, etc. There were clear directions. If you look at a series of judgment orders passed, even in this particular year, 2020, in the MC Mehta pollution related cases, it's all to the executive to act. So it is, yes, maybe climate change related specific litigation. Yes, there has, I don't think there is one. And I think they should step in if they can. I mean, even Suomoto, because it's now reaching alarming levels. I mean, or somebody take it to court, you know, in terms of, you know, the Paris Agreement and our commitments and where have they reached. The other interesting thing, of course, is a bit of a disconnect. Is that if you look at every EIA form that is to be filled, it has a column related to climate change implications. Now, nobody fills up this form. Interestingly, they don't seem to, you know, it's the climate change, though they generally use it, it has not become part of our jurisprudence yet, you know, climate change implications. Indirectly, yes, but directly, this sort of thing, you know, it's yet to sort of, you know, nothing much has happened, Quaidat, in terms of the judiciary yet. And that's also what is one of my key concerns, which I said at the very end.
Thank you, Ms. Anita. If you may permit, we would like to move forward to the other participants who are waiting in the queue. Shagun Sapru, can you please unmute yourself and ask your question live? Shagun Sapru. Shagun Sapru, this is last and final call for you. Please unmute yourself and ask your question live. No response from Shagun. S. Sridhar, please unmute yourself and ask your question live.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon to all the reputed panelists. I just wanted to know that with the LARR introduction, land acquisition is in 2014, land acquisition is becoming more and more tougher in India. While balancing environmental concerns, how would you suggest, ma'am, that we can ensure that India develops? Because we need a lot of infrastructure to counter with, compete with other countries in this fast competitive world. That's my question. Thank you.
Yeah. See, Justice Deepak Gupta, when he delivered a lecture, said, you know, there cannot be economic development without, you know, taking into account environment. We always see these two concepts, development and environment, as it is one at the cost of the other. No. You know, when you develop the environment, there will be development. You know, I don't have, unfortunately, those slides with me. But, you know, whenever you protect the environment and take care of it and take care that it's not, you know, there are no impacts on it, it leads to a GDP growth. I don't, in fact, don't have that slide with me, but there was a study done that whenever you have environmental concerns have been kept in mind, there is a definite and direct correlation to growth and benefit. So, you already have a lot of principles, you know, of sustainable development. You have development while, and you know, if life itself, the environment gives you so much, if you don't protect it, and you know, development can never happen at the cost of environment, you know.
Thank you, Ms. Anita. Shyam Mohan, please unmute yourself and ask your question live.
Good afternoon, ma'am. Thanks a lot for the great session, ma'am. Don't you think that it's a bit unfair to have uniform buffer zones and coastal regulation zones across India? Say, for instance, is it unfair for states like Goa, Kerala?
I want to know who is this, Shyam Mohan? You are a lawyer?
yes, ma'am.
Are you a lawyer practicing in the Supreme Court?
Yes, ma'am.
I don't know, Shyam Mohan ji, if you are aware of, if you look at the CRZ notification, they have very specific regional chapters. You must be knowing that.
Ma'am.
Hena? For Goa, there are separate chapters for Goa, there's for Mumbai, there's for Kerala. So even the CRZ notification, the general layout is common because it is coast. I mean, it's not that coasts in Goa are very different from coasts, say, in Tamil Nadu, right? So while the chapters are common, each state has a very specific regulatory mechanism. So it is not unfair at all, according to me. You won't get me to say anything that these laws are unfair. No, I'll Thank only you. Say Thank that they're not being implemented fully.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Mr. Madhukar Sharma, please unmute yourself and ask your question.
Thank you, Achya. Ma'am, there is one more question. We know that international instruments like Millennium Development Goals or the Sustainable Development Goals in the last 40 years, they have expanded the scope and meaning of the term environment.
Yeah.
Like now the latest SDGs of 2015, they have 17 different subject matters. Yes, and many of the subject matters have very loose connection with the term environment.
Yeah.
So when we in India, we are in the process of framing environmental policies, rules and regulations. Mm-hmm. Should also India invested resources in line of the sustainable development goals?
Yes. You know, you will find things like, gender. You know, one wouldn't look at gender justice to be a part of sustainable development goals, right? When you talk about these 17 new entries, yes, if you look at the Hanuman Lakshman Aroska judgment, they talk about these, like for instance, eradication of poverty, eradication of hunger, good health, well-being, quality, education. You're right. Now that is maybe disconnected with the environment, but they have looked at everything very, very holistically. So you can't disconnect it, you know. It has to be looked at in totality, and all these goals have a vital connection with each other and to the environment. So I don't have time, but please look at the Hanuman Lakshman Aroska judgment and how they deal with the SDG goals.
Definitely, ma'am.
Okay.
With permission of the host, ma'am, may I ask one more short question, please?
Short, yes.
Yes.
Hopefully this is the last question.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. What I know is that environmental science and research would definitely play a very important role while dealing with the environmental issues. But I am not aware of this fact. Do we actually have strong environmental science structure in our education structure?
You mean whether it's part of our curriculum?
Yes, ma'am. In it curriculum, is, right? In litigation things?
Yeah, we do. Isn't it part of our curriculum? I studied it 25 years ago. I mean, isn't that what you're asking?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, it is part of our curriculum.
Okay. Yes. To a great extent.
Yeah, it is to a great extent part of our curriculum.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, thank you, Mayuri. I hope that's all.
Ma'am, we do have a couple of questions in the Q&A box. I know the paucity of time, we may not be able to take all of them.
Yeah.
But with your permission, may I place two questions before
yes.
you?
Yes, okay.
So ma'am, this first question is from Mr. Shubhendu Malik.
Right.
He has a very interesting question. He says, I love to plant trees in urban areas, that is in his locality. But whenever I do plant a sapling at roadside, the nearby shop owner uproots it. Can I restrict him from doing this legally?
I don't know. I mean, what does he want to do? See, but where has he, if it's planted, say, on the street, I mean, there are only laws which say that if you want to cut a tree, then the Tree Preservation Act comes. But how do you stop a neighbor shopkeeper from uprooting it? I don't know. I mean, I really don't have an answer to that.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, the other question has come from students. This is by Ms. Anushka Singhal. She writes that our courts have acted as savior of environment several times. What can we as law students, especially the first year learners, do for our environment?
Well, how wonderful. What a lovely question. First is be environmentally aware as to what is happening around you. Because I feel that, you know, every decision that you take out of awareness is something that's going to lead to a positive result. If it is banning of plastics, even in your own locality, when you go to your shopkeeper, you'll say, "Arey bhaiya, tumne dobara plastic mein diya." You know, so many times, don't you know, I tell my shop, you know, I live in Noida, so I tell him, "Don't you know that now you can't use this?" You know, so at every level you can do it, you know. I mean, be it conserving water, you know, be it saying no to like leather products, somebody said, even to be nice to the street dog outside your house, you know, you can feed it. You know, it's all about being human and compassionate, and, you know, there should be humanity, you know. But please be aware, there's a lot of information relating to the environment in the public domain. So first is, as a student, you're a learner, a seeko, jano, you know, come to court when you have your, you know, when you have your internships, listen to the most important environmental arguments that take place, you know, go to the NGT, hear the things that take place. There's a, you know, in terms of information, environment is surfeit of information, you know. So you pick up everything, do everything, take one step at a time. You know, somebody in the Supreme Court, I'll tell you, Justice Indu Malhotra said, and while I was arguing a case, Justice Chandrachud happened to mention it. It's a very small thing. She said that, why do we have these small plastic bottles of pani, you know, during our meetings? You know, because these are single-use plastics. Please understand, single-use plastics is one of the greatest contributors to environmental pollution today. So she said that she got rid of it. Please have glass mein pani bhar ke piyo na, ye chota sa 100 ml ka, why do you want? You know, in the Supreme Court, we had plastic straws, which were coffee stirrers. So somebody, because you don't understand, see, plastics are carcinogenic. They have toxic elements in it. So when you put it in a hot substance like your tea or coffee, there's leak, you know, there's sort of, some of the toxins can transfer to food substance. There's a pending litigation on that. There are a lot of studies on how, you know, don't use plastics or cheap quality plastics to store food and medicines. That's a different subject altogether. So somebody went, and then now in the Supreme Court, I mean, now it's been 8 months, but there is now, you know, the wooden stick, wooden stirrer now. So somebody has taken that time and effort to go and talk to the canteen committee, and, you know, it really can be very, very baby steps, but, you know, I can tell you hundreds of things, but you can start with all this, and I'm sure you will come up with your own things as to how to conserve the environment and be part of this movement.
Thank you so much, ma'am. I know I'm flooded with more questions, but
I'm too tired.
I will have to apologize to the attendees. And I will request them, if they have questions, kindly email it to the college. And if ma'am will permit, we'll place them before ma'am some other time.
I can answer the emails. There's no problem.
Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am. It was a very enlightening session and very informative. And I hope that this is not your last webinar.
God.
And with this, I request Professor Dr. Ravangle, sir, to please come say a vote of thanks.
Ma'am, before I say anything, it was, there are very few sessions I always come across. And nowadays, People have been calling COVID times as the bad times. Rather, I said these are the best times which human beings ever would have in their life. And first, before I move, and let me thank you because you brought out some memories. Means I went. I remember a picture which was there into our hall. People call auditorium, etc. But in my school, it was called as Kala Dalan. Means Kala Dalan means there were no racks. There was nothing else, but people could just go. They can work out. Maybe it is their fine art, or it may be like their craft. And they can just put it with their name and people will come and will see it. But the best part, what was taught to us by our Gurujis were, we used to use the material which we again could reuse. So in our school, we always were taught you use it and further you reuse it. But we never, like I remember we using the papers, like they were called in Marathi, of course, Gudu paper and etc. But that paper, like for example, we made some art. So it is displayed, people liked it, they used to give, and then Guruji used to give some price to us from his or her own pocket. And then we used to get that show for a while. Next year, on our books, we used to have it as a book cover. And people used to love. So that was taught to us by our Gurujis, not by anybody else. Now, again, the second thing which takes me back, because of course, I also come from the agriculturist family. My father was the first who went to studies. He became engineer, but he never left agriculture. And we still are into. We are allowed to continue what we like to do, but we have not left what we are. So, in my village as well as the adjoining areas, we have. I have seen this that when they cultivate the land, if there is any tree which is pre-existing, they never pull it down. Rather, they will cultivate the land which is nearby or around it, but they never will pull it down. Rather, they see that when they get their lunch or when they feel they are tired, rather they say that it is the God's will which has come to their rescue. So they have that place. And under the tree, they will have their food, they'll rest for a while, and then they will continue with their work. We also have another in the village which is regularly practiced, that I'm talking about just villages, not the city, because now we dwell in city, my family as well, but we go to our fields as well. If you visit any house, you would be welcome with minimum 3 pictures. Of course, the first picture would be of one or the other god he or she worships. Second would be of the elderly member of the family. And the third picture would be of the bulls. Those bulls would be named and their picture would be there, and it would so graciously put forward that people, and then you feel, why the pictures of the bull? Because it is strongly believed in the society that they are the ones who bring livelihood, the food which we eat. So we need to worship them. And now, of course, I don't have to say about religion, etc. We take pride, our religion is this and etc. But we all have forgotten. Every religion has taught us by one or the other means the importance of environment. People call it as environment in English, but it is very simple. It is called as Nisarga. So when we talk about Nisarga and then comes the word, it is in Marathi, we always call as Nayanaramya. Nayanaramya means, you know, aankho ko bada achha lagta. And what you see and what you feel, you take it inside. So if you don't see it, you never will feel it and you never will take it inside. So I think that instead of we becoming literate, we need to be educated. And if you really want to get educated, you need to go back to the villages. Because the people have the wisdom, that is called rural wisdom. They may not have qualifications like us because we end up arguing why it is good, why it is not good, but they leave it. Ma'am, I also will cite another example that there are several temples. You go across India, you will find that there is either a tree which is around which that temple is, or if there is a tree in the area or the premises of the temple as well, people start worshipping it. So, and then if you talk to the pujaris or whoever is maintaining that, whatever it may be, the place of worship is, I have not come across building a place of worship. They ever have pulled down any trees. They ever have destroyed the areas nearby. I remember, if you see the oldest cultures, we always take pride that this is our architecture, this is our natural heritage, but still we go end up writing our names on it because we never have understood the value of it. But the ones who created, you will find that, you know, there is presence of all those Panchamahabhutas. And why do they say? Because one cannot exist without the other. But what do we see? We just see the Daiti. We don't see the Nisarga. That is another problem which we come across. And this remind me of another picture which was kept in my, we call them as Mukhyadhyapak, and it is called as principal or director as the case may be. And the picture was from anthropology, that, you know, the monkey to human. Mm-hmm. And that picture we used to see, and then we never were explained. Our Guruji or Mukhyadhyapak never told us what this is. But we learned that, you know, in stories that Bandar Aadmi Bana, like, you know, like this. Absolutely. So over the period, so I discussed this with, and I always have said that Bandar ne mehnat ki, woh aadmi ban gaya. Lekin aadmi ne kya kiya, iske baad kuch nahi hai. If you see, Bandar to aadmi is there.
Yeah, you're right.
After aadmi, there is nothing. Because, you know, then we just are standing still and we are looking for what nobody knows. Yeah. But end of the day, so that's what they say, that one makes the effort to become, and what we are doing it, we are trying to unbecome what we are worthy of. And that's what you rightfully brought to our notice, because you started with the slide 120,000 hectares. And then you talked about another statistics, that what is that? If you talk about the penalization or how many really have been held accountable. The whole theory, because Dr. Madhukar raised about the criminal law thing, because less serious and more serious is the struggle we all have gone through during our college days, law school days. And we were told civil wrongs are less serious. More serious are public wrongs, but nowhere we have put environment as which kind of wrong. Is it less serious, more serious? We said we are not bothered only. And then we come up with quite good terms, sustainable development. I'm not opposed to that. Polluter pays principles. I don't have respect or disrespect for that. End of the day, development of what? Development for whom? Development of what? Because we also have to understand. So we are growing, we are developing, but are we progressing is the question. That's what we always have been taught at school level. And our Gurujis always gave us high time, because they always were bound by, they always said, it's the value which matters, not what you become. If you have the value system in you, you become the value. So it is not you becoming the value, but you become the value yourself. So you nurture it. So why do we require laws to be told that, you know, we need to do this because this is likely to happen? I am also the violator. I cannot live without air condition. I also drink that bottled water. I also go to the ship. Ma'am, there are places in Pune as well. I love that place because I am saying with respect, they are arrogantly cultural. Why they are? Like, there are shops where you go and if you don't bring your bag, they will not sell things to you. They are not bothered about this, whether you can fetch it from other. They'll say, do you have that bag? Has to be yours bag, which is reusable. So you have to take your jute bag, buy your things, and then they'll sell you. If you don't have it, they will not. And I'm talking about the ones who are into business for more than 60 years, 70 years, 90 years. They said, no, selling is for our livelihood, not for bringing or taking out somebody else's life. They are like this. They don't do this. We call tribals. I'm sorry, just 1 minute I'll take tribals, because there are a good number of them who work in our fields as well. How many means, you know, we still are struggling when I will get that break and when I will take some rest. Ma'am, they work 7 days. In the villages, they are paid weekly. And it is Wednesday in my village. So Wednesday, they'll not work. Wednesday, they will not work. They will come, they'll take their salary, they'll enjoy. Of course, Sunday, you would not be working, because as an owner, you feel that Sunday is mine. So they get 2 days holiday and they get paid for all 7 days, but their pay is not much. And there is one more thing which I have learned from them. Most of the villagers, like I have seen, the husband will not come to collect the salary. The wife comes and she collects the salary because it is strongly believed he will not take it home. But the wife runs the home, so that's why the salary is taken by the wife. So you can understand, such is a culture in which we have grown up. Why do we have to learn from elsewhere? Why can't we go back to our roots and we realize it? And we will not require more laws. Rather, I think that education is important. And that's what you gave today. And thank you very much. I'm sorry, but as there was so much, you know, I could just get from my school days, etc. I keep on doing. And yes, that's the plan as well. I always have said this, going back to the roots. And that's good number of us have done it in our family as well. That after a while, they all leave and they go back and they start cultivating the land. So thank you very much, ma'am, for again made me think about my dream after a while, which I will again go back. So thank you very much. It was a wonderful session. So it was pleasure. We really enjoyed it. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Professor. Professor Avanli, seeking your permission to end the webinar for everybody.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Ms. Anita Shenoy. Thank you, Ms. Mayuri.